Hello, my name is Jessica and welcome to my channel. If you are new here, thank you so much for clicking on this video, and same to you if you have watched my videos before. A quick disclaimer, these are just my tips for what made my transfer successful. Did they all work? I don't know. I can't say definitively yes or no, but I can say I tried everything within my power to have a successful transfer. And just because you did all of these and you didn't have a successful transfer doesn't mean you failed as a person or in your methods or whatever. Or if you do none of these and you have a successful transfer, that's amazing. So it's just, I guess the word would be like anecdotal. Hopefully I'm like using that right. But if you have been trying to conceive for some time, and you probably have been or have been diagnosed with something like myself. Quick backstory, I was diagnosed with endometriosis in 2017, suspected it for 16 years beforehand before I actually got a surgical diagnosis. And I also have PCOS, I am 32 years old, and my husband had no male factor infertility. We did do IVF with ICSI because we didn't want to lose any embryos in the process. And we did that all in 2020. So I was pregnant for all of 2020, literally till the end of 2020. And we started IVF at the very beginning with me on birth control. So that's just a little backstory there. There are so many factors that go into having a successful transfer. It could just be luck, honestly. And there's so many things to consider, and we all have a different diagnosis. Obviously some people watching this will have the same thing as me, but yeah, just want to say that because I know when you go through infertility, little things can hurt, even if you don't want them to, or I think especially in our world today, it's just it's good to give a disclaimer, but also know that there's going to be some people that won't like it, right? Some people disagree with this kind of stuff. So anyways, so these are my successful tips. I've broken them. I'm looking at my iPad here because I have notes. But I've broken them into two categories. So one would be the old wives' tales, which a lot of you may or may not have heard about them. And then the other category, I just wrote other things. Some, to me, they're like really important things in my personal opinion, and things that I will do in my future transfer when we eventually do a frozen embryo transfer. So the first old wives' tale would be warm feet equals warm uterus. And the theory behind that is very self-explanatory. If your feet are warm, your uterus is warm and therefore can welcome an embryo. So I had my transfer in March of 2020, and I live in Alberta, Canada, and it's cold here. We have winter for most of the year, honestly. So it was really easy to wear socks. If you have a transfer in the summer, it's going to be harder. But so even if I got super warm when I was at work, it didn't matter. I just kept my feet in shoes, even if we had the off chance that it could be a warm day. The next thing would be McDonald's fries. So I've heard actually to have them after your retrieval is what a lot of people say because of the water retention that you would have after your retrieval. For me, I for some reason must have read somewhere years ago that you had them after your transfer. So that's what I did. We went, after we left the clinic, we went straight to McDonald's. My husband went in to get them, and I requested that they better be hot, fresh fries because we're paying for them and I want this transfer to work. Not that it would work with cold fries, but or wouldn't work with cold fries, but I love fresh fries. So I actually shared that in my embryo transfer video, and yeah, they were really good. And then after that, we drove to Five Guys and got burgers and fries and went home and just relaxed, which was really awesome. It was good to have a nice salty, yummy meal post-transfer. So that's my theory, is that it's for the transfer, not the retrieval, but to each their own. The next thing would be pineapple, so, or Brazil nuts. So it contains the, I don't know, chemical or whatever the name is, but bromelain or bromelain, I don't know how you say it. And you start that from your date of your transfer, I believe. I'll put on the screen like what the actual time frame still speaks. I'll look it up while I'm editing this. But yeah, so I cut up pineapple. You're supposed to eat the core because it contains the bromelain in it, or bromelain. And I just like cut up a whole pineapple and then made sure to eat that whole thing in the 5 days. Some people do Brazil nuts. So apparently I think the most you could have in a day is 3 and they become toxic or something like that. So I didn't think it was worth the risk. I'm not sure if I said this already, but bromelain makes your lining welcoming to an embryo. So then it will help let your lining like welcome the embryo. Yeah, I did the pineapple. The other thing would be palm juice, so pomegranate juice. I just got like the palm one. And I had that during my injection. So I must have did the pineapple. Okay, the pineapple doesn't matter. Just shut up, Jessica, about the pineapple. I had that during when I started my injections, like day one. So I actually had it in a wine glass and mixed it with water so that I felt like I was drinking wine, because you can't do anything when you're doing injections. Although some people will say just live your life as normal because it's better to be stress-free. But for me, I just had that like it was wine and it was nice. And I can't remember what it's supposed to do, honestly. I don't know if it has to do with the antioxidants, but again, I'll put it on the screen for what it's actually supposed to do. And then the next thing would be having warming foods. So that's like a Chinese medicine thing, or Eastern medicine thing, to have warming foods, because again, warm uterus, because you don't want to have a cold uterus because that won't welcome an embryo, is the theory. So I made sure to have soups. I prepped myself some like soups, and I only had like warm foods, no sandwiches, nothing refrigerated that was cold. I had lukewarm water. I was just willing to do anything. I thought we're spending thousands of dollars. It's really not that much of an inconvenience to try all these old wives' tales and other things. Because who knows what worked, right? There's no saying what works. So to each their own, right? The final thing for the old wives' tales would be IVF socks. So there's a lot of really great Etsy shops and even some companies now that make IVF socks for your transfer and your retrieval. But I completely forgot, because you know when you're on injections, you're super hormonal, and my memory was like shot. So I made my own. I ordered some socks from Amazon. And I bought transfer paper and used our iron and made them, because I just needed to have something. This is, like I said, old wives' tale, but yeah, I had to have them. So first, so since we had our transfer in March at Dollarama, which is a dollar store here, they like obviously had St. Patrick's Day stuff. So I bought like these socks. They just say got luck. And I wore them so I made sure to always have St. Patrick's Day socks on for all of my monitoring appointments. So, to check how the follicles were growing. And I also had these ones. So I just like, I think I might've had a third pair, but I don't know, I can't remember. But I just went between them and just washed them all the time. So I got these socks as well, which I am saving, because who knows. And I got my husband some as well. He wore on the day that he did his sperm collection. So these are men's ones. And then for myself, for the transfer, I made these socks. So at the bottom, it says lucky retrieval socks. And then the other foot says, go get him, doc. And the doctor really liked them. She's awesome. And unfortunately she's left the clinic now, so she won't be there when I go back. And then for my transfer, I made them on socks that you could see a little bit better, but I kind of messed up and I wanted them to be okay. So I got these from the dollar store as well, just some black socks. And then on this foot, it says lucky transfer socks. And then on the other foot, which is a little bit dirty, I think, or it's just like the thing, whatever. It says Poopo, which is pregnant until proven otherwise, and a little pineapple on it. So I ironed that on, and I'm saving these ones definitely for the frozen embryo transfer. Yeah, so it was really easy to do that in winter. I don't know how you do it in summer. I guess like wear shorts and then wear shoes and socks. I don't know. So that was the old wives' tales. And then the next area would be just like prepping yourself. Either you start doing this before you do injections, or you do it after the injections, like whatever you want to do, if you wanted to do it. But for me, I cut out caffeinated coffee. Since the very beginning of 2020, I stopped drinking it, and I would just drink decaf coffee because I need my coffee in the morning. I'm not one of those people who can just stop drinking it and then feel okay. I had to have that routine and that thing of waking up in the morning, having a hot cup of coffee, especially in the winter. But I just love having coffee, so I switched to decaf. And I know there's a tiny bit of caffeine in decaffeinated coffee, but it's a heck of a lot less than caffeinated. And then I also started making sure to drink a lot of water. So I started drinking way more water, and then also electrolytes. So having coconut water. I didn't have Powerades and stuff like that till after the retrieval, because for me it was like really important to make sure I didn't develop OHSS, although I did develop it after my transfer, because it being a fresh, you have a higher chance of developing it after, especially because your pregnancy hormones actually make your ovaries continue to grow when you've had a stimulation, which I had no idea. And the biggest thing is reducing stress. That's very easy to say and really hard in execution, because when you're going through infertility and when you're wanting to have a baby so badly, you can't just not stress, but you can reduce your stress as much as possible. So for me, I'm like someone who gets stressed out so easily. I really tried to let things just fall off my back when I was at work dealing with customers. I just had to try my best to not get pissed off and just relax, be like, I don't really care because I'm trying to make my baby here, you know? And I made sure to watch comedies. So I thought just like relaxing would be really good. So that goes into my next point of laughter. I really truly believe that being happy will help you have a successful transfer. Doesn't mean you will have it, but it will help you have a higher chance, because you just, I don't know, like when you're stressed out, just think how your body tenses up. I cannot see how like an embryo can make it. I mean, I'm sure they can, but I was stressed out through so much of my infertility journey. I had so much loss and I was so stressed all the time. And I'm sure that has some role to play. Like stress makes you sick, right? Stress can give you heart disease. So clearly stress has a massive role in our health and our lives. So after our transfer, we came home, like I said, had five guys, and I watched a ton of stand-up comedy and just like the stupidest things that would make me laugh that shut my brain off. And I just made sure to chill out. I just had that whole day off. I had to go back to work the following day, which is totally fine, because another point here is, which is my next point, is that movement really helps, in my personal opinion, because walking, it stimulates blood flow. And I remember reading online that it can stimulate blood flow to your uterus. So my clinic didn't recommend any bed rest. I know some clinics do. So obviously go off your clinic's recommendations. If that's what you want to, you have the freedom to choose to not listen to them. But I worked on my feet all day. So that day of the transfer, I fully believe 100% rest, like bed rest as much as possible. I was just like chilling out on the floor and on the couch, and it was really awesome. And then I made sure to be on my feet, not physical exertion, that you're gonna be sweating and you know your heart rate's up really high, just walking. So I was on my feet all the time because of work, but even so, don't coddle yourself yet is what my personal opinion would be. Blood flow to the uterus is great because it's going to help that embryo implant. The next thing would be to use a heating pad on low. So when you're pregnant in particular, they also say like, don't use a heating pad. So you're supposed to treat yourself after your transfer as if you're pregnant, which is the poopo thing. And heating pads are like a no-no, but I think on low is fine. Because it's like literally nothing. If you're someone who has endo, a heating pad on high even is like nothing for you, but definitely don't use it on high. I used it on high on my lower back, which is okay. You're allowed to, my clinic said at least, because I was having back pain, but I had cramping like that whole day. And it really helped to calm the cramping, in my personal opinion. And it helps during my period too. So I thought, why not? The next thing would be a Mediterranean diet. For me, I started doing the Mediterranean diet, which is like pescatarian type diet. I can list on the screen here what like all the just the general gist of it would be. So I started it a few weeks or like a month or something before my injections. I wanted to give my body the best chance possible. I've heard if you're on a diet longer, it's better. I definitely agree that there are more long-term benefits, but every little bit counts. If you are 3 days into your injections and you're watching this, start now. Just cut out the things that you can cut out if you want to, you know, and I'm not forcing you to, but you clicked on this video and maybe you're curious. And I also, before I started my injections, I actually drank a little bit of red wine, like this much red wine a day. I am not a red wine drinker. I've since started to enjoy red wine, but in the Mediterranean diet, the true Mediterranean diet, they drink red wine for health. And so I just had a little bit, but the day I started my injections, no wine. I didn't allow myself to have any alcohol. It was great to kind of like force myself, and I read like a fertility book, and it was really great to have that calming time, just me and a glass of wine before I went into the heaviness of IVF. Another thing, which is not like a food thing or anything like that, but it's a moonstone. So we went to Toronto October 2019 to see our friends, and we saw like Post Malone in concert. It was so fun. It was just like the greatest little trip to go on just before starting IVF. But we went to this little market and I bought a little moonstone, which is said to help fertility. And I carried it with me at every single appointment and around all the time. So it was in my little cute backpack that I wore all the time, like as a purse. And I made sure to have it with me at every single appointment and all the time. And even up until I got pregnant, I had it with me all the time. And I will whenever that appointment happens for my transfer. And I think, let me check my list. The thing I forgot to mention was I also took a Tylenol 3 before my transfer to help relax myself and therefore relax my uterus In the US, I believe often you're given Valium and you have the choice often to take it or not, so that you're relaxed before, because think about if the catheter goes in there and then you tense up and that could dislodge the embryo. So in Canada, we are not given that. I had T3s because I have endometriosis, and I'm not advising to just take a painkiller without the recommendation of a doctor, but it definitely helped me relax. Even take a Tylenol and an Advil perhaps to help yourself relax if that's what you want to do. So once again, I'm not encouraging taking medication when unnecessarily, but I mean, they do it in the US. I just don't know why they don't do it in Canada. I think that's everything. I actually thought this video would be a lot quicker, so thank you for sticking around if you did. Like I've been saying the entire video, it doesn't mean it will work for you, but these are all the things that I did and my transfer was successful. I'm very thankful, blessed, lucky. I feel it's just so awesome that I have become a mom, because when you're in fertility, you feel like it's never gonna happen. And if you're somebody who's maybe just doing IUIs right now, and then you're thinking eventually you're gonna have to go to IVF, you know, it's gonna be okay. It sounds like the biggest thing in the world, and it is. Really allow yourself to feel that, but there is light at the end of the tunnel. And I know there's people out there who've maybe done IVF multiple times, and it feels like the light at the end of the tunnel is getting further and further away. But I just would encourage you to have hope if you can. So I hope that you found this video helpful, informative, and let me know if you did anything that I listed for your successful transfer, or if you're about to go into your transfer and you're just watching this for tips. I'd like to know if I'm helping at least even one person. I have no idea, but if you don't wanna comment, totally cool, but I just think it's cool to know if this is helping anybody, because that's the whole point of doing videos, is to help people out there. Thank you so much for watching this video, and if you haven't subscribed already, please consider subscribing. And if you like this video, give this video a like, and you will catch me, and if you're here, in another video next week. So thank you so much for watching, guys. Have a great day. Bye.